Well, good morning. You guys are here for the earthwork presentation in the wrong room. All right? So this is Ashley Pavlou and Nolan Worth. They're with McCown Worth Construction. They're both in Estimator. So they definitely get this. But this is one of our probably coolest classes to me, is using the BIM 3D model to estimate. And they've been doing this for a couple years for us. We really appreciate it. And so it's really using the BIM model, building information model, 3D model for estimating. So I'm going to get out of your way, but these guys are going to wow you with their technical prowess, okay? So ask them hard questions, okay? I'm asking you, ask them the hardest questions you have, okay? All right.
No pressure. Thanks, guys.
Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming. As Aaron mentioned, we're both with the McCown Worth Construction, and I'm here to give you a little bit on our BIM for estimating. A little bit about our company history. We were founded in 1999 here in Kansas City, Missouri, and that's where our headquarters is. We recently moved down on the main street, and we have satellite offices out in Manhattan, Kansas City. Do about any kind of construction, civic, corporate, education, healthcare, about everything you can imagine. So, I'm Ashley Pavlou, Senior Estimator.
I'm Nolan Worth, Project Estimator.
And I think we'll just start off talking a little bit about the design technology.
So this will be kind of real quick, not to spend too much time on it, but some of the progression on more of the architects programs. So here's a example of what kind of used to be. It was all hand drafted. This is just a scanned in version of it, but you can see through drafting in a straight edge, they obviously just drew everything out. And there's no intelligence embedded in any of the documents. It's all just simply a viewer and a picture. Been working off of, still got all the sections that you got to reference, and cuts. And as we kind of progress in time, we've been able to get it digitally into CAD. You're working off your computer now. You can kind of enter some smarter methods and enter in a 40-foot line, and it'll draw a line for you, so you can be a little more efficient and precise. But it's still nothing really embedded in technology that you can pull data out of. Revit is this program here. That's when we're starting to more get some smarts behind what's being drawn. It's not just lines anymore. It's going to be an object that you're viewing. You can select your objects through multiple views. You're selecting something in the 2D view, you can have a window up, see it in an isometric. We'll have an example of that coming up. But it's more truly represents a piece of the overall project, and it's not just a plan sheet that you're viewing. On the left, you can see there too, there's more data that you can embed with the drawings that you're using. And all this data is then exported to our 3D viewers when we're doing quantification in our estimating programs, and you're able to pull from all this data set that the architect's been building for us. This is again just another quick example. You're able to import images and parts and pieces as an architect when you're drawing. So that you're not having to recreate everything each time. This is a quick example showing a T that they're putting in some ductwork. You can reposition it how you want it. You can have a total count when you're all done to where, again, as an estimator, you're trained to just go count them all, and you still do for reference, but it gets you a quick starting point when you export and say there's 250 of these T's on the job. You can shoot out quick reports and then apply some pricing, and you'll have a gut check estimate pretty quick. This is an example. You can see in the 2D view, we've got the door selected. It'll show up elevation view, same door. You can find it in the door schedule, it'll select it. Just the same as the isometric here in the 3D. And that's kind of throughout the project. Any piece you're selecting, it truly is an object within the program. It's not just a line anymore.
Next, we'll just kind of talk a little bit about the progression of the estimating technology. Probably not many of you have ever actually scaled drawings and colored them, measured them as out by hand. That's where I got my start. Did that originally. Eventually, using the calculator and just an estimating book where you write down all of your quantities and forming your estimates from that. Eventually moved on to digitizers and made everything a little bit easier. You were able to just kind of trace your lines, and it was put into a computer through a spreadsheet. And then eventually, here's an example of some OSTs, so an on-screen takeoff, where you're able to trace it. You get all the quantities, you get square foots, linear foot areas, everything. You can pull everything off of here. And then here's an example of the 3D technology. This is using Revit for importing these into a program we use as called Assemble. Basically, it allows you to be able to pull all of the quantities out of there as well as recognize them and sort them and categorize them however your estimating software is set up. We use Timberline, so we sort everything like your base all options and then bid items and bid packages. So kind of gives you an example of how we do that.
And that information on that left is the data pulled out of the architect model in Revit. So on the left of Revit, when we were seeing all that data kind of embedded in the quantities and walls and floors, that's what's pulled over automatically.
It's a good point, because when you're doing a 2D takeoff, you're creating all your own conditions for everything as you're pulling it out of the information presented to you in the design documents. Here it's already embedded in there, so it saves us a step and quickens the process quite a bit. And then here's just some examples of the output. Here was a digitizer tab. This was exported into an Excel spreadsheet almost, and gives you kind of a graphic of what your takeoff represented. Here's the takeoff tab from on-screen takeoff. These are on the left-hand side of that is the conditions you created, and then you got the quantities that you can apply to that either by count, square footage, linear footage, however you want to set that up. And then here's an output from Assemble. Basically, we can export this back into us. Excel again, and it gives you, this is a ceiling example, it gives you the type of ceiling, where it's bound, quantities, and any pertinent information over their family and type is typically where the architect or the design teams put in, like manufacturers, or get more detail into it.
This is Johnson County Arts and Heritage Center. Project we built. We used a lot of Navisworks in the pre-construction, specifically on this job. It was kind of before we got into Assemble. And it's the same thought process. I mean, there's a lot out there. It's just a viewer that you're able to take the architect's modeling and start categorizing all the different walls and quantities, just like you would in a 2D method. And you're able to group and export those tables, like Ashley was talking about. And from that, you can then apply some pricing. To date, you can't really fully just trust the 3D models. We're usually viewing it on one screen. You've got the 3D model up. You can kind of see wall heights. You can see what you're looking at on early conceptual schematic plans where you don't have all the information yet. Some of the names you can pull from this is always helpful, because it gives you an idea of what the architects may be thinking about to come. But ultimately, you're able to just view what the architect's done. You're not able to change their model. You're not able to redraw. But that's where if pieces are missing, you've got to supplement that in your estimate still in a 2D takeoff. And there's some programs out there that are kind of working to merge the two. But we'll get that a little more later. Here you can see color code. Really helpful when we had 100 meetings. We'd be able to pull out options on this project. They were looking at whether they want metal panel, glass, fiber cement board, whatever it may be. You're able to quickly price up option and show them exactly where it's included. So they're on the same page of what you're pricing.
They did a section yet?
No, it's running off the thumb drive. It's taking a little longer to do a slow down.
Oh, there's a, go ahead.
No, I could use Assemble before, but you're saying that you transfer the data out of the model into Assemble and they categorize it?
Correct. And we've got some examples coming up, but essentially there's an add-in through Revit. You go in, you open up Revit, you say export to Assemble. You can pick which models. The architect will have a master file. It'll have architectural, structural, AMP. You don't have to pull everything, you can, and then you can organize it how you want to see it. So each time there's a new updated model, you can keep everything flowing to the same area so that you can see those different design iterations.
Is that just because the data in the 3D model is set up for us as estimators?
Yes, but so you can still pull all the architect's data. Assemble lets you view it and reorganize it how we want to see it. And especially like if they label the floor, the ceiling.
So you can double check.
You can double check it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good. Assemble, look at different versions of the models to compare, you know, what changed and how that impacted cost.
Yes, so we'll have a good example coming up.
We can do a change analysis between different iterations of the same model.
Yeah. A piece that's not going to load here is the section. You can put a section to the building, kind of drag it through and look at cross-section of the building just like you would for an architect's plan sheet, except you can put a slicer anywhere you want it. You can put it through the x-axis, the y-axis, however you want to see it, so that you can better understand what's actually in the building. There's a ceiling in there that's kind of hung at diagonals, 2D plans, which just show it's a flat plane, but again, you're able to see there's a more thought process that needs to go into it.
All right, we'll talk a little bit about the uses for BIM and estimating, obviously, since it's kind of the purpose of this class. So, the needs here are improved estimator efficiency, basically. And as we can show you, your efficiencies are so much quicker with all the model and the information in that already pre-built for us, that we're just categorizing it and sorting it through our system. Able to identify and track changes and cost. And it's also a method of organizing model, you know, by our bid packages is how we do it. That's part of the categorization process. Obviously, with the improved efficiency, you know, we're meeting our tighter deadlines because it seems like nowadays it's we're getting a version or an SD document or wanting to turn around and they want instant feedback or quicker feedback when, you know, because they're continuing their design and they don't want to be going down a path where, you know, the total budget.
Yeah, that kind of avoids tedious manual takeoff is when you're to the DD and CD phase, when the models are pretty complete, and you're able to just upload the model, quickly assign the change, and then kind of look at it, make sure it's making sense, and that the budget's going to be on track, but nothing's changed. It's an easy way to flag things.
Also, you know, there's getting more and more widespread access to models. That's an important part is just, you know, and we'll get to this a little bit later with our levels of development, you know, explaining to the design team what we're using it for. I know there's still some hesitancy out there with some groups that are not wanting to share their models, but if you can explain to them what we're going to use it for, not that it's, you know, because obviously the model's never going to be a contract document, we're still contracted to the actual 2D plans. It's just, you know, explaining, getting their input. Some challenges that everyone's facing is, you know, the tighter deadlines, the, you know, manual the tedious takeoff and the estimate process, and then incomplete 3D models and 2D drawings. Successful value engineering, making sure we're giving them options that are actually going to save them money in the long run, and then the very competitive market. Talk about your quick uses.
So pretty much what we're doing with the model is we're taking all the quantity harvesting, sorting it how we want to see it in our final table. And then trade partner budgeting, we've got a good slide coming up kind of showing how easy it is to send it to a trade partner. Hey, these are all the drywall partitions we got on the jobs. There's going to be five different wall types at this point in design. You can color code them all so they can quickly look at it. It's not taking a ton of their time up. It's got a grand total square foot for them, and they can just quickly look at it and say, okay, yeah, this is something we feel comfortable. This should be $10. This should be $12 here. So it's really helped the turnaround, and you're not sending stuff, waiting 2 weeks to get it back, which again, got a lot of their workload too. So.
Yeah, we understand all of our trade partners are as busy as us, and they're not working just on our projects, they're working on everybody here in town. So it's just trying to get some advanced information to them, that way they're not having to do the complete takeoff as well. And then, as we were alluding to earlier, you could do the cost design regression analysis, and we'll get some more information on that. It's able to compare models, you know, from an earlier iteration to a current one, and it'll show you what's changed, what they've added, taken away. And it's a good way to track any value engineering that you've done along the way, like making sure that that got put into the drawings and the design documents as well. Quantity harvesting here, we'll kind of run through a few examples of that. This is just an extraction of the quantities, the scope items from the model, and then do a system analysis as well. Here's the information provided from Revit once we published it through into Assemble. On the left is kind of the model tree, and that's all of the items that are pre-baked into the model. You know, it's categorized by, you know, casework, ceilings, and so on and so forth. So it, you know, just kind of gives you the generic information. Then we start sorting it through bid item and cost code. Here we're assigning properties to these actual elements within the model. You know, on the right, you can see, you know, I've identified that this is a base item. It's an exterior 6-inch exterior metal stud. It's going to be in our 90 bid package as part of the building. And then the location was, this is part of the middle school on a affecting three different buildings on this project, so we identified that those schools we can sort later if we wanted to. And then quantity. As you can see, there's tons of properties over there we can assign. You can either do as many as you want or as little, or you can customize them and make sure that they fit your operations or procedures in your office.
You can make a library of all those pre-made conditions so that each time you're doing your takeoff, you're just clicking from the drop down. And that's clear. Data tree, and we'll get to that in a second. You can type pricing into it so that you can apply pricing quickly. We haven't ever used this as our final estimate by any means, and I don't think that's where we're going to take it. But again, it's a quick, I got a model in, I'm going to do a quick budget check in 2 hours, see where I stand, and if there's a big variance, I need to maybe raise a red flag to the owner or the architect.
Here's, after we've assigned properties to all the elements in there, we start sorting it by bid item and cost code here. As of now, we've got these all approved. Hopefully you can read that. You know, it's like 2D site concrete, that'll be our bid package there, and then 3D foundations. We've got everything kind of sorted into those bid packages. That way it'll give us a quick gap check and be able to identify all the items within that package. Categorized properties. So here, this is sorted by a bid item. Again, we've got, this is a metal stud wall example. Here we've selected, there it's the highlighted one, the basic wall. Again, it identifies it in the model, so you can see where that is, as well as on the 2D plan. So Assemble has the option, you can be looking at the model and the 2D at the same time as identifying your quantities and selecting them. And then here's the properties that we've assigned to that one, to these specific objects. And then we'll go through and do this for the entire project.
So that all the information you're filling out on the right, the properties you're assigning in, are called assembled properties. And all the information pulled from Revit on the model properties. So there's two different kind of smarts to the model. at that point. There are ones that the architect made from the modeling, and there are ones we assigned to help you want to see it. So the visibility filters is a process where you can literally just filter out what you want to see. You can just see walls, you can see floors, you can see roofs, and just zone in on one particular trade or a section of the building based on how you assign the information. When you're signing assemble properties, you can be saying area A, B, and C, and then you can pull up exactly what areas you want to look at, maybe for an owner meeting or just whatever estimate you're working on. So you can see here's an example, the full model, pulled through. Nothing has been filled out with the visibility filters.
I'll jump back to this because you'll see quite a bit of difference between this and the next slide where we've actually applied the filters.
So what we've filled out here on the left side is we want drywall partitions. We don't want ceilings, which could be pulled through with some of the drywall filters. So then we've set again without any ceilings. So that allows us to just look at our drywall package at that point in time. Once you apply some pricing to your estimate, each time you're filtering your sort, it's going to be giving you an updated total of just what you're looking at, as long as all of your costs are filled out.
Another example of that is, so as you can see on this slide, there's quite a bit more building there than what's showing up on the right-hand side with the domed roof. That was an existing field house that was going to remain, as well as on the left-hand side was the Performing Arts Center that was going to remain. We were just doing some minor modifications. Once you get in there, you can see there's just, now it's just showing the new middle school in the middle of the project, and a handful of walls off on the right and left are the minor modifications that we're doing to the two buildings that we're doing.
And you can save where you're at. You can save a certain view if you like what you've selected. If there's a whole bunch of junk in the model you don't want to see from now on, you can filter it out one time, hit save, and then reopen that same setting to always just load what you want to look at. And you can go back and switch between the two, but it's not like you got to open the model and hide everything every single time you want it. So now, this is kind of a filters template you can make. You can import this to every future project you're working on. What we did here is made 9 different settings, and we filled out the visibility filters to say if you have cabinets, counter, whatever it may be, any millwork item, then it's flagged it with a casework template. And if you open that specific view, you can see all those filters on the left, so it just saves the filters. Same thing with the ceilings, the walls, masonry, exterior skin, a lot of that stuff. The architects are always naming it the same stuff. They'll label it with the EXT, exterior, somewhere in the name. And as long as you know which data fields they're always filling out, you can basically pre-pull all the information. So you're not renaming everything, resorting everything every time. You can basically sort it once and then adjust it as needed, but it takes out 95% of work. This is a quick example of the total cost. You can see in the columns, everything's pretty much able to be manipulated to where you can make the tables however you want to see it. In this view, we just wanted to look at this specific multi. We've assigned $40 per square foot for the full assembly, brick, metal stud, and then that will show the total cost for what we're looking at. If we were to unselect half the walls, it would update your total to just what you're seeing. So again, this is where if you fill out all your costs and then you start filtering through, I want to go get my masonry, and as long as you've filled out all your costs, when you go to your masonry view, it's going to have a masonry. Click on drywall, it's going to have a drywall for you to open. And that gets into the data tree. And this is how you pre-make your catalogs, your libraries, put your unit costs in. And you can change them for each job, but you at least get a starting point this way. So the data trees and then the project settings, they provide a unit format template for you, and that's where you got to go in and export it to Excel. Change your descriptions to whatever your company database is, and then you just re-import it, and it's all there for you.
allows us to create visuals and, you know, export information from quick budgets from our trade partners to kind of speed up the process and save them a little bit of legwork. Here's an example, a visual example of just the ceilings, it looks like, on a project. Kind of on the left is the visual, and on the right is your component, the export that has been pushed out to Excel. As you can see, everything's kind of color-coded in there to where they can quickly identify, you know, the different types of ceilings. You know, as an example, the compound ceiling chipboard is red, and you can see it runs pretty much all the soffits along the corridor walls. And then change analysis. This allows us to prepare earlier versions, you know, to make sure we identify any changes that were either added or deleted, or if it just changed quantities. Model comparison, this was a project we did for over in the Lawrence School District. So this is a good example that, you know, the green represents anything that was added, red represents anything removed, and then the rest is either type change, quantity change, or type and quantity change. But this was a good example of checking the design team to make sure that they were implementing any cost options or value engineering that we had done. The great big red box on the top was a penthouse that they had originally drawn for the mechanical equipment, and we had weeded that out to just put the mechanical spring around it. As you can see, the green was added, and the penthouse was taken away. So it was just a good, quick visual check that they had done what they were told. And then model comparison. This again, just kind of, this is the quantity representation of it. On the left, the categories, and then, you know, green and red represent pluses and minuses in quantity. So it's again, real quick, just visual check, you know, making sure that, you know, everything's lining up with what you wanted, or if you see a pretty big swing in a number, we can, you know, bring to everyone's attention and make sure that either they've got it modeled correctly, or that, you know, we're tracking on where. I mean, you see a lot of large increases as the design progresses and more finishes, because a lot of times on the estimate stage, they're not putting in carpet or ceilings sometimes. There's just boxes for rooms, and then as the design progresses, they're going to start adding that. So you'll see all those quantities increase, but as long as you're aware of what you account for.
Usually it's you got your takeoff in OST and 3D. Basically, your quantities at OST are going to zero, quantities in the book are 2 or 3 you take off. So you should still have a baseline that that should do. Not going to spend a lot of time here, but it's just kind of the responsibilities of the architect and what level of design they're at for how much information they need to put into the models. So you can see earlier on, at levels 1, 2, and 3, there's not a whole lot of information. When you're getting into level 4, that's going to be more your construction documents that you're building off of. It's got all your parts and pieces. And the next slide is going to be a quick table that just kind of help represent that. You can see if you follow the colors, 1 shows, it just, you know, identify a substructure, shell, and as you get into your 3s and 4s, there's more description for what you're actually addressing. And again, that's going to be tied into, you can't just take what you get and just assume it's complete. You've got to do your thorough review of it. Make sure you're understanding what you're pricing. This is an example of some wall types on a project we're working on. You can see there's only 10, 12 items within that list, and there's not all the walls drawn on the floor plan yet. And in comparison to that, on the next slide, you can see they've put a lot more detail into your wall types, whether there's additional layers of gyp, different acoustical insulations to ceiling, the structure. The architect's now putting that into the model, and you can see they've actually drawn more walls too. But again, that's a good talking point. You can do a quick variance, say, hey, my drywall is grown by 20%. Some of this wasn't ever identified in a 2D floor plan either, so chance to align your budget without just saying, oh, I miss a lot of walls.
Here is, you know, just kind of checking, this is an example of, you know, a change analysis on a project of just the flooring. And noticed that my epoxy flooring had grown, like, more than doubled. It's watery, and I was like, hold on, what's going on here? Isolated it out down in there, and as you can see, the two red layers there, basically what they had done is they'd come back in and drawn the floor again and didn't erase the old one, so they basically just duplicated the item and already went through. So again, you gotta be careful about the information that's in there. You gotta be able to double check it and make sure you're seeing the same things. Another example is a square feet versus gross feet. So now, a lot of our, this is an example of a ceiling on the left hand or the lower left. They've got the ceilings drawn in there, but everything, you know, all the width or the light fixtures is taken out of it. Well, if you're just asking for the square feet of the, you know, the square feet of that space, it's going to take out that quantity of light fixtures. Well, that's not how it's going to be priced. The trade partner is going to, you know, charge us for the entire room, not just the room where the lights are. So we have to go through the gross square feet, and then it gives us the total square feet of that, that space. Another example, full height versus, you know, partial height or ceiling height, drywall. Very similar, you gotta be able to make sure you're accounting for all the space that's shown in the drawings.
So some possible uses outside of estimating, trade partner progress tracking, scope review with trade partners. Again, just having a quick representation. You can either sit down in a meeting, spin a model around, look at what the job is, and talk through it. Phasing diagrams for visual representation. We've got a kind of an example coming up that you can kind of scheduling into your model and kind of look at how it's actually going to be built. Change order analysis is more on the field side, but as you're getting your updated plans and models, you can kind of run the same comparison checks that you would during the construction process. And then construction dashboards, I put that down there. Obviously, Power BI is a big program right now. You hear a lot about it, and it does have a link to Assemble. And any sort of database that you're going to be working with, you can pull into Power BI. So it's understanding that there's potential for dashboards that you can look at the information, not just the table, but you can look at stuff graphically.
They all have a place. So this is basically an example. Early on drawing, this was an SD. It's actually a fairly good SD drawing that we'll get, but it was one sheet. And I was asked to price an entire project based off of this one drawing. Started looking at it. Yeah, I could take off the walls for a second. I can work on a lot of that input, or a lot of the information is in here. But, you know, what does my roof line look like? What's, you know, have I got a lot of parapets or anything? Well, if I got the model from the architect finally and gave me a little bit of a better understanding, I was like, okay, so that center section, that's another 6 feet taller. So I have to figure out all that, you know, obviously the wall height there is going to be drastically changed, as well as the exterior skin. So it's just a good example of how we were able to get way more information on a model than you're going to get from a 2D drawing. And then here's this leads into a little bit of an add-in for what we've started using here with Rubik. This is a kind of an example of a model where you go in there. A lot of times the room is identified as just a space, but they may not already have finishes or anything applied to this. The Rubik app allows us to put in, you know, build a basically a room schedule or a finished schedule from the model. Allowed to identify the rooms and then apply properties to them, either any progress, ceramic tile, what kind of finishes on the walls, as well as ceilings. Again, this is taking a little while, but starts identifying all of these rooms, and then we're able to export it out into kind of a finished schedule. This is the floor finishes, and it, you know, applies quantities to them, and then it calculates them there as well through Excel.
I think there's a lot of kind of power to it in the early conceptual schematic deliverables to the owner and the architect. A lot of times I know I've had to make assumptions on all the finishes, and put a snippet of your finish schedule and say, this is what I got. Right or wrong, we'll kind of align it during the DD update once you provide the finishes to us at that point, but this is kind of what we're basing it on something. This is a picture of Prairie Fire Museum that we had built, I believe, in 2014, 2015. Back then, we had used SketchUp. You can see there's a lot of diagonals in the building. There's really not anything on the same plane. So if you were pricing off elevations, it's going to be really hard to get your true square footage. Some of this glass was, I believe, $150 a square foot. So mistakes will add up really quick. What they were able to do is use SketchUp and kind of view it, turn it, see where the planes actually go in, meet the next plane at a diagonal, and you can actually pull quantities from SketchUp too. So they were able to kind of check their quantities in multiple areas, and then there's not a big surprise during the DD budget update when you get more information, and we didn't account for all this because we didn't know, we didn't really understand all the depth to it. This is kind of our next, again, just looking more at operations application. And there's a lot going on the screen, so I'll try to talk fast. Upper left is just a viewer panning, kind of showing you how the program works. The top right is going to be showing a clash detection. And looks like it may not be working with the jump drive. But basically just that it's going to graph everything in the X, Y, Z coordinate. Got 2 points on the same spot, it's going to throw up the flag, and then you can review it with the design team. Obviously some things can change in the field, they don't have to be exact, but then there's pieces for structural steel that meets duct. Obviously we can't move steel, so if the duct can't move either, then you got to bring it to everyone's attention. Lower left is supposed to be showing a phased schedule that you can assign durations to each property, so then you can kind of build the project in different scenarios. Sit down with your superintendent, your project manager, talk through kind of what the flow of the building should look like, and then you can take that and present it to the owner and say, this is kind of our plan. That's part of the logistic package. And then the bottom right is just a representation to help show the team that in order to cut this wall out, a whole lot of wall, there's some parts and pieces that have to take place. There's some shoring that should be shown. Maybe it did, I guess. Didn't talk fast enough. And then here we've got an example. There's a walkway here, and when they're modeling the 2D detail, they want to compare it back into the 3D model. And it helps the architect understand kind of the spacing of what they're looking at, how much clearance they're going to have. Can the contractor actually get it installed when they're doing this work? And they're going to basically overlay a 2D image into the 3D model. But it allows you to basically take a picture and align it on the plane of the model so that you can see exactly what you're looking at with more detailed information. May not get there.
And then you move on.
Yeah, you can see the next one too.
So that's pretty much it. Any questions?
A lot to rush through there, but I'd be more than happy to field any questions, talk about assemble more. Obviously that's the kind of most exciting part is when you're actually taking the quantities from the model.
Sure. You know, is there a generic software that we need to be able to work with various types of software that the general contractors are using for this? Or do we need, you know, like, not every construction company is using the same software.
Right. Right.
So do we need to have certain software that we need to improve on this to put 3D models and things like that? Visualizing the same.
Okay. No. Most everything goes back to what we're asking. It's either a Revit or a drawing viewer or something along those lines as our basis that assembles the program that we use for our internal takeoff and whatnot. I can export that usually into either it's a visual, it's just a JPEG, and then everything else go into an Excel document. So it's pretty simple that way. As far as doing the actual takeoff of the contract documents, most likely we're not going to show the model anyway because that's not a contract. It's when we're doing the actual bidding, contracts can be typed in 2D documents at that point. That answer, was it clear enough?
Quantities are pretty much only as good as the architect that draws them. How has the reception been in conversations with the design team and getting them to draw models more accurately?
Well, a lot of them don't follow that LODA. They're only going to give you the information that they're contractually obligated to do. And actually, I've found they're getting better. They're getting more and more complete, and it depends on when they start and to the model itself. I'll see some of them that they'll start drawing in Revit from day one, whereas others they'll typically sketch up to popular programs that's easy and manipulate for them through the programming and then up to ASPE, and then that's when they start moving into the Revit model itself. And the information's actually been pretty good at this point, just because they're tight, they don't want to have to redraw it. I mean, that's money out of their pockets as well.
Right. You think there will be a point in time where they become part of the contractual documents model?
Maybe down the road, so I don't know. Right now, I would foresee it in the next couple of years. There's a lot of programs out there making 2D/3D platforms where you can do the takeoff. I know Autodesk is currently working on one. That would allow you to fill in the gaps and keep all your takeoff in one set of data. So that when the architect isn't drawing a wall, but you image a wall, you can take it off in 2D, it totals into your full estimate, and you can kind of fill in the gaps as needed. But kind of like you said, it's tied to the LODs and early schematic conceptual models. We don't really base our estimate off of them. We're pulling heights of the building and understanding how the building fits together as a whole, but we can't really use the data at that point. But you can use it as a deeper, from what I've defined projects.
I've had good luck sitting down with the design teams and actually spinning it through assemble and saying, making sure everything's aligning with their expectations. And they've been having receptive to it.
But yeah, early on, there's usually one wall type that you see 80% of the walls. And then they go back and they reorganize and click on the wall and change the data on the left side. But they don't have time to do that all early on. Otherwise, you go from LOD 0 to 3 and you just skip the first two steps. So in the early design phases, they get that time to fill out the info.
We're still working on a lot of narratives at that point, at the early stages.
Simple web-based.
It is. So it's a cloud-based program.
You have multiple estimators in there at one time.
Yeah, we've got an enterprise license, so basically all of our estimating department has access to it. And we can be working on the same model. We can all be working on the same model at the same time.
You just better take it the same.
Yeah. Or hopefully we're not working the walls together at the same time.
Have a chance to flag it in the assemble properties and maybe flag it as an alternate. I haven't necessarily, usually if they're going to model something, let's say if they're going to change the layout of the building, it's going to be hard to have the two models unless they truly send two separate Revit files. Then you would have a chance to capture the change. But otherwise, I can't say I've used it a lot for the alternates.
Yeah,
I have used it once. It was basically when we were exporting it into assemble, I had to turn off certain layers for base bid to turn off the alternates, and then I'd load that, and I'd load a separate model with the alternate, and I was able to prepare quantities out. It was just took a little bit of more legwork in the front end, but
just manipulating a few layers of the actual model itself before you import it into assembly. And the web-based is nice. I can pop on here right now. Work on it.
And it's not real slow. There's a little bit of lag time as it's loading, but it's only 2-3 seconds. It just depends on your internet speed. It doesn't bog down like some of the programs when you're working remotely. You know, trying to log into a server in a different office, and it takes you minutes to load stuff. It's not like that. Well, we kind of briefly touched on it, but you've always got tracking of models 1 through 10, whatever it may be. A lot of architects are using BIM 360 or platform sharing website now, and constantly kind of updating the model. You can then go just pull whatever the current model is, maybe put it like budget check, March 10th, whatever it is. And the model doesn't necessarily have a name other than the day you downloaded it, so you got a reference point, and it's always tracking. That way everyone knows if you're looking at a quick update, hey, this is from this model specifically, so we're looking at a month's newer model. Yeah, it may not have everything, but it, you can just kind of maintain the budget better because you always have a data feed. And even if you're not looking at the price of the flux today, you can throw it in assembly, do a couple quick checks, and then just move on.
Yeah, that's a good point. We've been working on a project here in the next couple of months where we're RSD estimate, ED estimate is due to the owner at the same time that their documents are. So we're estimating it live with them through BIM 360, where they're giving us access to the models as they make changes, and then we can just pull them down. Again, a little bit of the trust. We had to reiterate them. We're not changing anything. We're not modifying the model. We're just using it for models.
Do you find that designers, as you're using this with them, they're having to build your models, not having that double up and things like that, but being more cognizant of how they're placing things for your use?
I've been getting a little bit, I've seen a little bit of change. Have you a little bit on that?
I know that's already been a challenge in the past. I don't see a slot model, but that floor example was a great example of something you constantly.
Most of everything I've been seeing is really pretty good. Usually the issues I run into is just if maybe there's not a wall in a certain spot, or maybe it didn't get drawn tall enough, and it's that the problem occurs when you export your table, you don't have the full quantity. Well, if you didn't do it in 2D, you lose it. Make note of it in a separate Excel file, you lose that quantity, and a week from when you would build your estimate, if you don't have that, that's when kind of the risk could come in. But again, hopefully in a few months we've got that 2D, 3D platform to where you can build it all in the same estimate, but there's again less risk to lose it.
And as you work with the designer more and more, you start to learn some of the tendencies of one here in town, writing new names, but I see a lot of they draw like a floor slab, and they'll just kind of copy it.
Yep.
So my roof is also labeled as a concrete slab, but it's actually not out where the floor finishes. It's just kind of learning that and making sure that you're, when you categorize, you assign it the correct properties.
You can find out a lot of how they model, though, in the left Revit information. So when you pull your model in, you can do a review process. 5 minutes, and they did it. You can see exactly how they model. You can see if they modeled, because it's going to be your kind of superstructure, so what proceeded each piece. You can see if they grouped it by building, by floor, or just dove right in and did it by trade. But you can understand how their thought process kind of worked. Anything else?
A few more minutes. Well, I guess we'll talk about cheese. We'll talk about cheese.
I think the biggest, I guess, progress we made in the last 2 years was finding some of these, you can make it custom to your own library, or not reading with everything, and there's more consistency throughout the department. You can define what people want the estimators to do, and is there when they're taken off. You can do the kind of gut check pricing, pull from whatever estimating database you use. Again, it doesn't all have to be pinpoint exact, but it just gives you a quick update. And it's all in there anyways, it's not like it takes a ton of extra work.
I've seen a little bit of use of VR and AR mostly for, you know, like the other night, like saying, oh, this is what it's going to look like. Here's a right for your face model. Has there been any use for that in estimating?
I've done a little bit of that with, so we had a client over one of my school districts. It was very visual. Showing numbers and those ASPE displays over, so we started showing more visual stuff, and I was able to bring up some stuff like where it was a multi-phase project over a two-year span, and I was able to identify the different phases and plan the food model and walking through that. And he seemed to get it a lot quicker and was more receptive to it. So yeah, I've seen a little bit of that, and I touched on a little bit with the progress tracking. Because you can assign a property as a phase or a timeline to as one of your properties, and you know, like these footings are going in phase one, these footings are going in phase two, and you can identify them and, you know, just start walking through that way as well. That's even useful with, you know, trade partners when you're doing a pre-construction meeting with them and talking scale and one, being able to identify the sequencing.
What's the interface between
So they used to have a bridge that you could tie them off to your timberline descriptions. I think they dropped it in the last couple months because they're working on their 2D, 3D platform, and I think they might try to reintegrate it. What we found is as soon as one description is off a little bit, they don't talk anymore. So if it's not matching perfect, you're still having to sort through all your takeoff and then click, I want this item to go to this price, and there's a whole bunch of the same as you would export it and just replug it in, except you're just trying to tie the two together. But as soon as the architect adds models and changes stuff, then it kind of breaks that link you had. And then again, if you don't do a full thorough review, you can't really
but they're in the process of correcting that and coming out with their own version. So this was third party that they had worked with before, now they're going to do it in-house.
And again, it's not that it couldn't work, but we weren't able to get the two descriptions to always match, and we felt it was a lot of still the same process you would just export.
Yeah.
And mark key. But it's got, obviously, Autodesk is huge, so their Power BI connection, all that stuff.
If there's nothing else, we'll give you